Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is on the Holy Spirit and spirituality. And this is lesson number 10 in that series entitled The Holy Spirit, the Word, and Prayer. It's the lesson for March 11 of 2017. I think you'll find this very, very provocative, something really to think about. I really enjoyed and was challenged by studying this lesson. So let's see what we can learn from it. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, once again, we recognize your presence with us, and we ask especially for the guidance of the Holy Spirit as we seek to study his role in the whole plan of salvation. Help us to recognize how we can pray, how we can read our Bibles and study, and thereby communicate with you so that we can become like you by beholding. That would be the ultimate goal of each one of these lessons, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So in this lesson, we're going to talk about faith. We're going to talk about Bible study. We're going to talk about the fulfillment of God's will in our lives. The purpose of prayer is to, well, it's really supposed to draw us closer to God. It actually, if we can use the words of Scripture and Ellen White, it lifts us up into God's presence. So could our lives be transformed by a combination of Bible study and prayer? Looks like it should happen, shouldn't it? So we need to ask God, and it's one thing to ask, but it's another thing to really ask, like you really, really intend to do it, how we can accomplish his will in our lives. But God must always be at the center of our prayer lives. What would that mean? How would we understand God being at the center of our prayer lives?
Talking with him and listening to him rather than asking him for something.
How many of our prayers are based on selfish ideas?
A better question, how many aren't?
Easier to count.
How many of our prayers aren't, give me this, give me that, in maybe subtle ways, Basically that's it. Be with my family, be with my kids, be with the grandkids.
Bless those call parties and missionaries, whoever they are out there. Yeah.
Well, in Romans, Paul tells us that we don't really know how to pray as we ought. So the Spirit then intercedes for us on our behalf.
And what does that mean? Well, what would happen if we spent some time on a regular basis praying for the people that we disagree with?
Might change your mind.
Might change your mind. Ooh, dear me. What then? One of the things that's
character.
Yeah. One of the things that's obvious is that we're not praying to God to change his behavior. We're praying to God, ideally, to change our behavior. So look at the words of Jesus in John 15, verse 7. If you remain in me, remember, this is talking about the vine. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you'll ask for anything you wish and you'll have it. So I can get a new car, a new house.
Should have said anything.
What?
The genie in the bottle?
Yeah, the genie in the bottle.
Was it ask and believe? Or something goes like that, you know?
Ask, believe, and claim.
It's interesting that in John, four times he says, ask in my name. Mm-hmm. And if we consider that the word name is also the word character, in other words, if you ask according to my character,
yes,
his character is a character of love. If we ask with love intentions of love in our hearts, we are going to be asking the right things.
Yeah. In other words, if we became more and more like Jesus, we would ask more and more things that would be as like the things he prayed for.
And beneficial to others.
And beneficial to others, exactly. And in our context in these lessons, we're saying beneficial to the church, aren't we?
Well, the traditional prayer, Jesus says, I'll teach you how to pray. One is, ask for your daily bread.
Yeah.
And wasn't much else. Well, don't protect us from the evil, yeah. And that we not be led into evil, but that's it.
Yeah.
And beyond that, it's...
Okay, I have a question for you. What do you think the disciples of Jesus prayed for daily as they fought with their fellow disciples over who would be the greatest in the earthly kingdom they were sure was going to be set up?
Well, I think you just said it. They prayed for themselves in those specific examples.
And do we ever do that?
I hope not.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
I always try to start out with a prayer of thankfulness.
Mm-hmm. How often do we talk with Jesus as we would talk with a friend without asking for anything? This wasn't a call for silence.
We'll just thank him that he runs the universe the way he does. Uh-huh. And that he's forgiving, and that he's, you know, you can depend upon him, and it doesn't take a lot of words to string that together.
We could bring a lot of quotations that basically say God cares about every detail of our lives. Why should we have any trouble talking to him about the details of our lives? I mean, if you see a friend that you haven't seen for a long time, what do you talk about?
What have you been doing?
It just boils out, doesn't it? Yeah. Well, as we suggested, prayer is not to change God. It changes us because we are brought into the life-changing presence of God. Look at these words from Steps to Christ, page 93, paragraph 2 and 3. Through nature and revelation, through his providence, and by the influence of his Spirit, God speaks to us. But these are not enough. We need also to pour out our hearts to him in order to have spiritual life and energy. We must have actual intercourse with our Heavenly Father. What does intercourse mean?
In this case, communication, back and forth.
Back and forth, exactly. Our minds may be drawn out toward him. We may meditate upon his works, his mercies, his blessings, but this is not, in the fullest sense, communing with him. In order to commune with God, we must have something to say to him concerning our actual life. Now, prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. Not that it's necessary in order to make known to God what we are, but in order to enable us to receive him. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but brings us up to him. Wow.
In Thoughts from the Mount of Blessings at 188, she says, when we are admitted into the closest intimacy and communion with God, we may be said to dwell in the secret place of the Most High.
Mm-hmm. There's
passages in Psalms that
exactly
amplifies that.
Are there any aspects of your life that you wouldn't be comfortable discussing with God?
He already knows it all, so.
Yeah. Well, when we're watching television, would it affect the way we watch television if we knew that Jesus was visibly sitting next to us?
Or invisibly?
Well, he's already doing that.
But why would we need to have him visible?
But we will remember it.
Hmm.
You know, I think that's part of the challenge is to actually bring him into those kind of places.
Mm-hmm.
If a person has a drinking problem and he ends up in a bar, he should just bring him with him, bring the Lord with him.
Maybe things happen
when you do that kind of stuff. What?
Maybe it'd be better to stay out of the bar, huh?
No, I mean, you know, when you've got a drinking problem, you'll end up there.
Mm-hmm.
And what people do is they say, oh, I failed, you know, and they don't think about him anymore. But if they could brought him in with him,
then they might
things happen.
Leave and be right with the Lord.
They might. Maybe not that night, but the night after, right. Maybe, whatever. But I think part of the problem is that that the devil talks them into God is gone. Mm-hmm. You know, just
well,
that's
we
the way it is. See, you blew it again.
We used to teach our young people that if you go into a movie theater, he stays outside.
Well, I don't think that's a good thing.
Well,
yeah, God wasn't there at all, and the angels stayed outside. Yeah.
In Ministry of Healing, she says, the reason why so many are left to themselves in places of temptation is that they do not set the Lord always before them. When we permit our communion with God to be broken, our defense is departed from us. Not mm-hmm. all your good purposes and good intentions will enable you to withstand evil. You must be men and women of prayer. Your petitions must not be faint, occasional, and fitful, but earnest, persevering, and constant. It is not always necessary to bow upon your knees in order to pray. Cultivate the habit of talking with the Savior when you're alone, when you're walking, when you're busy with your daily labor. Let the heart be continually uplifted in silent petition for help, for light, for strength, for knowledge. Let every breath be a prayer.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So in this chapter, we're going to talk about a three-step process. One, we need to ask God to fulfill His promises to us. That doesn't mean ask for what we want ourselves personally. It means asking God for what He has promised already that He will give us. Two, we need to believe and trust God that He, in fact, will do these things. And three, we need to prepare our lives to receive and claim what He has promised. So, how does that all work? Don't we believe that God knows and understands us better than we do ourselves? Remember, God knows not only our past and our present, He knows our future. There's nothing at all about us that He doesn't understand. So when we ask God for something which is in accordance with His will, that gives Him permission in the setting of the great controversy to give it to us. If God were just giving us what He knows that we need, but for which we have not asked, then Satan would cry foul. He would say, you know, you don't have permission to do that. He didn't ask for that.
You're imposing, God, you're imposing your will on that person.
Yeah.
You're going against His free will.
Now, long ago, I gave God permission, though, to... Seriously, I gave God permission to give me and help me anytime. Mm-hmm. When I'm wrong, correct me, make it happen. It's hard to explain.
Not just the words of Ellen White. Here we have the words of Peter in the book of Mark. For this is Mark 11:24. For this reason I tell you, this is Jesus speaking actually, when you pray and ask for something, believe that you have received it and you will be given whatever you ask for. Isn't that pretty? That's one of the promises. There are estimated 3,000 promises like that in the Bible. Why aren't we claiming them, or should we be? How would we claim them?
Now, are there some conditions on that asking and whatever?
You would have to ask that, wouldn't you?
I think the next it probably says, means a little bit more than, I want $1,000 today, Father.
Yeah. Well, here's what the next verse says, and when you stand and pray, forgive anything you may have against anyone, so that your Father in heaven will forgive the wrongs you have done. So there are some conditions.
I think it's what we're praying for makes a difference. If mm-hmm. we're praying for the unity of the church, Well, that may not happen, but...
So if our requests are selfish, how's that going to promote the unity of the church? Or the kingdom of God?
We're trying to build our kingdom instead of His kingdom. It's going to be a clash.
We must ask for forgiveness, and then with God's help, we must seek to forsake our sins in order to really benefit from God's gifts we talked about earlier. We truly can ask God for anything. Nothing is too small or too great or unimportant to talk to God about. Now we may, you know, David talked to God about his sins, and then finally he said, you know, God, I'm really sorry, and please, you know, create a new heart in me. But he talked about his sins first. Well, what are those conditions that we require before we can have an honest conversation with God? Do we need to be willing to submit to His will? Yes. We need to set aside some of our sinful desires.
Yes.
And I quote from Christ Topic Lessons, page 145, paragraph 1. So it is with every other one of God's requirements. All his gifts are promised on condition of obedience. God has a heaven full of blessings for those who will cooperate with him. All who obey him may with confidence claim the fulfillment of his promises. Wow. Surely none of us have any doubts about God's generosity. So we should come boldly to him with our thoughts and our desires. And the Lord is, look at these words from Ellen White, Signs of the Times, August 7, 1901. The Lord is not glorified by the tame supplications which show that nothing is expected. Do we sometimes pray like that? He desires everyone who believes to approach the throne of grace with earnestness and assurance. Is that characteristic of your prayers?
So is that saying we are supposed to ask for things?
Yes.
We're supposed to have bland prayers?
We are supposed to ask in accordance with one or more of the 3,000 promises that God has given in the Bible. Well, now, yes?
What's meant by assurance?
Well, we trust in God.
Does she mean that you believe it's going to happen?
Yes.
What if it isn't what the Lord wants to happen?
We're going to talk about that in just a moment, so hang on to that question.
I kept thinking about when I was a kid, I wanted to snow next day. Of course, you know, I just did it because I wanted to have sledding with my friends, but didn't think about all the farmers that needed to get their crops in or anything like that.
Yeah.
So
they were praying for no snow.
Yeah.
While you were praying for snow.
That's right.
Hmm. We have talked quite a bit about faith and how that relates to the Holy Spirit and to God. Faith is a word which describes our relationship with God. Hebrews 11:6 actually says or tells us that without faith it is impossible to please God. How can we know that we are asking according to God's will unless we're very familiar with the Bible? I mean, that's where the promises are, right? People have twisted God's word to support almost every imaginable thing. I'll never forget a sermon that I heard one way back. I think I might have been high school or something like that, boarding academy. And someone talked about this. He wasn't praying. He just talked about a sermon he'd heard that way back there were these very high poofy hairdos that women were so popular with, beehive things. Mm-hmm. And so this guy got up and says, "Let the top knot come down. It says so in the Bible." You know what the verse was? Mm-hmm. "Let those who are on the housetop not come down." I mean, you can twist the Bible.
On the housetop. Yes.
You can twist the Bible to say almost anything you want it to say.
Was that Matthew 24?
Somewhere,
something,
yeah,
like that. Matthew, he was quoting against the beehive.
Yeah. Well, look what James says.
I apologize for interrupting you, but also the beehive is in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
But in a different context.
Yes.
Okay.
But when you pray, this is James 1, 6-8, but when you pray, you must believe and not doubt at all. Okay? Whoever doubts is like a wave in the sea that is driven and blown about by the wind. People like that, unable to make up their minds and undecided in all they do, must not think that they will receive anything from the Lord. So, Gary, I think you were one of the ones asking questions about this. We're supposed to ask in faith. Gordon, I think you were asking about it. Do we want to be as unreliable as the angry waves of the ocean?
Now, we can ask and believe it, but we can still be polite and say, please.
Well, what did Jesus do? He would be our example. Think about his prayer in Gethsemane. Not my will, but thine be done. Yeah. So the better we get at following God's guidance and asking according to Scripture, asking according to God's will, the more likely we are to get answers to our prayers. Wouldn't that be reasonable?
Yes. Yes.
Well, but there was that woman that, you know, begged and begged and begged, and the king finally says, Okay.
Mm-hmm. What are we supposed to learn from that?
Yes, amen.
Well, that, no, go ahead.
Said that we should persevere and not lose heart in our requests. But God is more willing. Sometimes Jesus sets up these
contrasts.
You know, God is more willing to give.
I know.
Gifts, good gifts to his children.
Yes.
Yes. Many years ago, a friend was unable to get pregnant, and I prayed desperately. When she finally got pregnant, she ended up divorcing the father. And I'm kind of going, okay, I prayed so hard. Was that wrong? You know, I question.
Yeah.
I was
God
sincere.
Wrong to answer your prayer. I mean, it wasn't like you manipulated the situation.
I hope
God's.
Yeah.
That was their decision also, so.
Yes, but you know, you think about that, and the woman, you know, and I've learned a lot about how I pray from that situation.
Okay, if we, yes?
I was just going to say, regarding what you were saying there, it reminded me of Abraham mm-hmm. praying when the three angels, whom I believe one was God himself, mm-hmm. came through the camp, and Abraham was very persistent and in getting, you know, more people saved or something. So, and then of course Jacob and everyone in the Bible, they were very strong in their requests. Jacob wouldn't let go until he got what he wanted.
Well, and was that because they were just selfish and they wanted what they wanted, or was that because they had finally reached a place where they knew that what they were asking for was according to God's will? See, if you ask for something that you know is selfish, you sort of have a hinkling back there in the back of your mind that, you know, God's probably not going to grant this one. But if we know that we're asking for something that is God's, according to God's will. Now, let me take an example. There are a lot of parents who have prayed for a wayward child that's left the church and who knows what they're doing. And so they pray fervently for that child to come back. And what happens? Many times they don't come back, at least not right away. Is that because God doesn't recognize their prayers? Or is it because God refuses to violate people's freedom?
Well, you can pray for people's salvation. Mm-hmm. Is that doing any good? Because after all, it's all up to them to make the decision for salvation.
Doesn't God want everybody to be saved?
That's right, but is there a point for us to even pray for somebody to be saved? Since it's all up to them? I think it is. I think it does do good.
Mm-hmm. I think I'm going to get in trouble with a lot of people, but you know, I agree. It's our own decisions and everything, but I think that God is a parent who loves us, meaning everyone. And if you've got people praying for you, and even sometimes I think maybe God may just say, you know what, hey, I'm going to help them anyways. And maybe that's violating something sacred or whatever between...
Let me support you, okay? I am absolutely certain that in light of the great controversy, if there's a group of people praying for something, God is a little bit freer, at least, to do that if it's according to his will than he would if nobody was praying for it. Because otherwise, Satan would say, you can't do that. That's not fair. Mm-hmm. So our faith is based upon the absolute certainty of the reliability of God's word. Could we say that?
But I think you also have to say that prayer with an absolute assurance that whatever God's decision is,
yes,
it's right. We don't know the end. We don't know what consequences.
Well, do we know for sure that God exists?
Yes.
Do we know for sure what's going to be the ultimate outcome of the great controversy?
Yes.
Is there any possibility that God could lose?
No.
Okay. Is there any possibility that he doesn't want a meaningful relationship with each one of us?
Logical thinking.
He wants.
But when you have stepped back and slipped away from your Bible study and prayer and you've been away from it for a while and you go, there's just no way. I've lost that connection. How do I get that back? Mm-hmm. There's that fear that is just inherent with humans, I think.
Well, one thing I can guarantee you is this. God does not ask us to trust him as a stranger. We know about the dangers of trusting strangers. So, how do we get to know him? Obviously,
through his word.
Through his word, yeah. Hebrews 11:1 tells us not so much what faith is, although many people take it to mean that. It tells us what faith does. I'm quoting from the New American Standard Bible. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. The assurance of things hoped for. The conviction of things not seen. What does that mean? We don't always see what's coming, do we?
And we can hope for anything. Mm-hmm. But it may not be based on real faith. You can hope to, for some people anyway, to win the lottery or whatever.
Yeah.
People put a lot of hope in that. But is that walking by faith? And faith leads us to fix our hope on things that God's promises have spelled out for us.
The angel Gabriel said to Mary on that very interesting occasion, with God, nothing is impossible. And she got pregnant. Look at these words from Ellen White that are sort of related to that. Volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 228. Prayer and preaching without the exercise of living faith in God will be in vain. But the touch of faith opens to us a divine treasure house of power and wisdom. And thus, through instruments of clay, God accomplishes the wonders of his grace. So how do we grow our faith?
Through exercise.
Yeah. Romans 10:17. Faith comes by the word, and the word comes by the teaching
hearing.
By hearing. And hearing comes by the
word of God.
The word of God, or teaching about Christ. Well, so what is God actually asking us to do in terms of prayer?
Commune with him.
Commune with him, exactly. How can we practice communing with God as we do with a close friend? I remember the first time I really went through the Bible with a group, looking at like these passages and really, really trying to ask, what does this book in the Bible say to us about God? And one of the people in the group said, I think I'm biased by using the name God. So he said he would read a passage, he'd read the book of Deuteronomy, for example, and every time he came to the name God or Yahweh or something like this, he put in the name Henry. And when he got done, he said, by the time I got to the end of the book, I was really mad at Henry. You know, so we need to think about how we're relating to God. Do we just sort of, you know, he's out there and we believe he exists, but he's not real. You know, do we ever have that kind of an attitude? Well, look at 1 John 5:14-15. We have courage in God's presence. Because we are sure that he hears us if we ask him for anything that is according to his will. He hears us whenever we ask him, and since we know this is true, we know also that he gives us what we ask from him. Sounds like a pretty blanket promise, doesn't it? Do we thank him for fulfilling his promises to us? Ellen White said in the book Education, page 258, for any gift he has promised, we may ask. Then we are to believe that we receive and return thanks to God that we have received. Does that seem a little phony? Are we, or is that presumptuous?
Well, faith lays hold of what God has promised to us, so we're looking forward in hope to that coming to us, but it's the assurance that it will.
If we really follow those directions, asking and then believing and then claiming and thanking God for us, would that make it more real to us? I think one of the reasons for telling us to do that is it makes it more real to us, and it makes in the sense that we say, yeah, God, I'm really talking about reality here. I'm not, you know, this is not pipe dreams and so forth. This is something that is real.
C.S. Lewis talks about pulling on a rope that's going through a wall, and then suddenly something tugs back. You know, mm-hmm. It's kind of that aha moment. He's there. There's somebody mm-hmm. there when he answers our prayers. And
somebody posted, and it's one of those things on Facebook, but it hit me. In prayer, we often ask for something and it doesn't happen. And this person was a Christian man and got stuck on an island when his ship went down or something. I don't know what it was. But he prayed and prayed and prayed for something to happen, and nothing was happening. And he was stuck there, and he finally built a little hut. He wasn't somebody that could do those type of thing, but he finally built something to shelter him. And he went off to find some food and came back, and here was his hut up in flames. And he's going, God, why? Why? And the next day he got up and here was a ship coming to rescue him. And he goes, how did you know I was here? Well, I saw your smoke signal. things happen and you kind of go, why? I mean, but when you look back, when you can then look back and go, God answered my prayer, just not quite in the way that I intended it.
Yeah. Exactly.
I think on the other hand, we have to be careful what we ask for.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely.
Because what we ask for ought to be more about, God, reveal yourself to me for what you are. Because eternal life is that they know thee, the only true God. If we don't know him, how can we grow into him?
Mm-hmm. Well, one excellent example of how we are to pray and to have faith and to claim God's fulfillment is the story of the resurrection of Lazarus, as recorded in John 11. Remember, Jesus was down on the other side of the Jordan River in Gentile territory, trying to protect himself from the wrath and anger of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And he gets this message. Lazarus is sick. And his sisters, I'm sure, Lazarus' sisters, figured Jesus needs to get there as fast as possible. He doesn't come. He doesn't come. Lazarus dies. And Jesus says, what? It's time for us to go there. Lazarus is sleeping. Well, Jesus knew all the time exactly what he was going to do, right? Don't we believe that?
Yes.
And when we get to verses 39 and 41, it says, Jesus says, take the stone away, Jesus ordered. Martha, the dead man's sister, answered, there will be a bad smell, Lord. He has been dead 4 days. He's been buried 4 days. Jesus said to her, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believed? They took the stone away. Jesus looked up and said, I thank you, Father, that you listened to me. What does he see? You know, the grave is still there. The man is still wrapped up in the clothes. You know, there's no movement. He's not alive. And Jesus is saying what? I thank you, Father, that you hear me. I know that you always listen to me, but I say this for the sake of the people here so that they will believe that you sent me. So I think that the thanking God is a way of our saying, yes, this is real. I would be happy for some feedback and disagreement, fine, whatever. I think that's at least part of it.
Yeah, I don't think this is a simple. Prayer is not simple. Even though it's simple to do, it's very complex in where you are in your relationship with God.
Yeah. Again, from Ellen White, Christ Object Lessons, page 172, paragraph 2. The Lord says, call upon me in the day of trouble, Psalm 50, verse 15. He invites us to present to him our perplexities and necessities and our need of divine help. He bids us to be instant in prayer. As soon as difficulties arise, we are to offer to him our sincere, earnest petitions. By our importunate prayers, what's an importunate prayer?
Persevering. Keep
persevering, isn't it? We give evidence of our strong confidence in God. The sense of our need leads us to pray earnestly, and our Heavenly Father is moved by our supplications. Wow. So, are we prepared? Do we know from reading the Bible what things God wants us to pray for? Are we prepared to pray for those things? Look at Ephesians 3:6. I ask God from the wealth of his glory to give you power through his Spirit to be strong in your inner selves. And then compare that with Acts 2, verse 38. Peter said to them, each one of you must turn away from your sins and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ so that your sins will be forgiven and you will receive God's gift, the Holy Spirit. So is the Holy Spirit willing to dwell in a heart that's full of sin?
No.
Don't think so. So he says,
is it a matter of willingness or just the heart or the individual has just rejected it? Mm-hmm. You know, it can't force itself on you.
Yeah. Well, he wouldn't.
Force itself on you. Truth is not, doesn't impose. Well,
that person may come to the Lord at any time, mm-hmm. you know, when they want to communicate and petition before the Lord, and maybe their heart will be changed and come to the Lord in earnestness.
Does the heart have to be changed before the Spirit comes in it?
Well, I think there's a lot of selfishness that needs to leave, probably.
But how does that happen without the Spirit being there?
It needs the Holy Spirit helping us to shovel it out.
So the first question you asked confused me a little bit, and then you said, does the Holy Spirit come to a heart that has sin?
Well, that wasn't quite the way I said it, but that's a fair question.
That's the way I heard it.
He's not. What I was trying to say, maybe I didn't say it well, but I was trying to say is that he doesn't plan to dwell in a heart that's full, that we continue holding on to our sins.
Not dwell in the heart.
No.
God will ultimately honor your choice.
Mm-hmm. But the man who's covered in mud and filth, he's willing to go there and help him mm-hmm. when that man wants the help.
So, once again, we need to say the biggest single objection, the biggest single problem preventing our prayers from being fulfilled is us. Usually we're unprepared to receive the Holy Spirit according to God's plan. We need to repent of our sins. We need to recognize that God's plan for our lives is the very best one possible. And then we need to seek each day to live lives closer and closer to the pattern Jesus laid down for us. The Holy Spirit can hardly wait for us to cooperate in that way with Him. That's a tall order for selfish human beings. But we must never question God's willingness to do it. I love this paragraph from Ye Shall Receive Power, page 284, paragraph 3. The heavenly parent, and this is, of course, just a paraphrase of the Bible. The heavenly parent is more willing to give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him than earthly parents are to give good gifts to their children. I don't know how it is in your house, but when Christmas time approaches, my wife just goes all out, and it's especially for the grandchildren, you know. And if God is more eager to give gifts, he gives us gifts than she is to give gifts to our grandchildren. I see somebody smiling over here. What does that tell us?
We just spent almost 2 weeks with the grandkids, and Myra had about a present a day for them.
Yes.
For each of them.
Yes. Yeah.
It's fun.
Yes, exactly. I remember my good friend that was a very busy physician, occupied and so forth, and didn't seem to have that much time with his own kids, but finally the grandkids came along and mm-hmm. his children became doctors and dentists, and they were scattered around the country. And so on one occasion, He and his wife had to go all the way across the country to visit one of their sons. And they were there for a couple of weeks, and he had nothing to do except play with the grandkids. He came back and he said, if I knew how much fun grandkids were, I would have skipped the first generation and gone straight to the grandkids. I had to chuckle when I heard that. Well, I mean, we do that not because the grandkids are begging for it. We do it, and they might be, but we do it because we love them. And think about how God loves us, you know?
I heard a couple, I think a non-Christian physician and another person discussing their parents, and they said, yeah, my dad spent more time with the grandkids than he ever spent with all of us kids. And two of them agreed about that it's the same with their family.
Yeah.
All off trying to earn money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now they're old enough that they don't need to earn money, and they spend time with the grandkids.
Yeah. Ephesians 2. We have looked a lot of that stuff in Ephesians. Ephesians 2, in verse 18 of my Good News Bible says, it is through Christ that all of us, Jews and Gentiles, are able to come in the one Spirit into the presence of the Father. And whenever I read something like that, I have to remember Galatians 3:28. Do you remember what it says in Galatians 3:28? Let's look at that for just a moment. So there is no difference between Jews and Gentiles, between slaves and free people, between men and women. You are all one in union with Christ Jesus. Wow. Could we live that kind of lives? Without that relationship with God that we call faith, we can hope for nothing. Our spiritual lives will go nowhere. That relationship is built up through Bible study, with the Holy Spirit helping us to understand in prayer. The Holy Spirit will teach us how to pray. You mentioned that, Dennis, back there, Romans 8. But every Christian knows that there are times when we pray for things, and this was commented on a little bit earlier, pray for things which we think are right, but they do not seem to happen. So what should we do when God does not seem to respond to our prayers? And again, I'm reading now, this is from Review and Herald, November 19, 1895. It's also in Heavenly Places, 89, paragraph 3. But be not discouraged if your prayers do not seem to obtain an immediate answer. The Lord sees that prayer is often mixed with earthliness. Men pray for that which will gratify their selfish desires, and the Lord does not fulfill their requests in the way which they expect. He takes them through tests and trials. He brings them through humiliations until they see more clearly what their necessities are. He does not give to men those things which will gratify a debased appetite and which will prove an injury to the human agent and make him a dishonor to God. He does not give men that which will gratify their ambition and work simply for self-exaltation. When we come to God, we must be submissive and contrite of heart, subordinating everything to His sacred will. Wow. Is that easy for selfish human beings?
That would be impossible for, I mean, really selfish people.
Well, go ahead.
I was just going to say, but if we're regular human beings with a little bit of selfishness, which we should not have in us, I think we can overcome it. It might be a little difficult, but we should keep trying.
Mm-hmm. So try to answer, and I'm going to throw this to you out there. Try to answer for yourself this question. What has prayer done in your life? What spiritual impact has it had? Well, a careful reading of the Bible, and I would say Ellen Wright's writings would do the same thing, tells us that basically three things that God asks us to do. Bible study, prayer, and those are the ways in which we communicate with God, and witnessing to others. And why is the witnessing important?
When we have to teach something to someone else, we learn it much better ourselves.
Learn how much we don't know. Yeah, absolutely. Well, how many of these three steps do you think the Holy Spirit is involved?
All of them.
All of them. No question about it. Do we truly, honestly pray that the Holy Spirit will be able to use us to accomplish God's goals? Or do we more often pray that God will help us to accomplish our goals, even if they seem to be good goals? Well, we've already seen repeatedly that God is more than willing to give us the Holy Spirit. He wants us to understand, He wants to help us to understand the life and teachings of Jesus Christ from Genesis to Revelation, I would say. If we allow Him to do so, the Holy Spirit will fill our hearts and our lives in ways which are completely unimaginable to us at this time. So, getting to some specific questions. How often do you pray about things because you want to talk to your best friend about them? He says He will give us the best gifts, right? Psalm 84:11 and James 1:17. So I would suggest that the most meaningful way to enjoy a better relationship with God is to combine Bible study and prayer. Now, I shouldn't talk about myself, but I will just tell you one of the things I do. I run a lot. I love to run. I run out on the hills, up and down, back on this, chase away the coyotes and that kind of stuff. But as I'm doing that, I'm listening to God's Word. I listen to the Bible. I listen to the Spirit of Prophecy. Right now, I'm going through a lot of material on the Great Controversy itself. And quite often, I find myself jumping up and down. Here I am running on the hills, so thankful for something I just heard from God's Word. And I thank God for that. That's wonderful. Now, you don't have to, you know, because I have a little machine that talks to me, that's great. But reading it, listening to it, anytime, any way, God has a chance to open our minds and to fill us with really worthwhile things. Well, what happens if you read a portion of Scripture and you can't figure out what in the world is talking about?
Pray about it.
Pray about it. Is it appropriate to look at a different version?
Read it again.
Read it again.
And in a different version.
Try a different version.
And maybe keep going, because it all could be like a jigsaw puzzle. The more we read and study, the things that we didn't know before kind of come together for us.
Okay. Now, we've said that there are three steps: asking, believing, having faith, and claiming. So if we finally understand a passage, would it be appropriate to thank God for that insight we've just gotten?
Absolutely.
Seems like it to me. Again, from Mellon White, the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald, June 4, 1889. If you seek the Scriptures, I'm sorry, if you search the Scriptures with a meek and teachable spirit, your efforts will be richly rewarded. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. The Bible should be studied with prayer.
Amen.
Unfortunately, for many Christians, prayer has become more of a duty than a delight. It might even be monotonous, or as we go on repeating the familiar phrases over and over again. You stop and think about it. God is an intelligent person, right?
Yes.
Absolutely. Does He want us just to repeat the same stuff over and over again?
No.
We could go to the prayer wheels that the Buddhists use and so forth like that, if that's all God wants. Well, we may not be able to see how God is involved in any way. What could you do to make your prayer life more meaningful? Could you have a favorite place to pray? Could you have a special time to pray? Do you have a regular meeting with God on an assigned time? Well, one of the things that would be useful is to look at what happened with the life of Jesus. When we observe Jesus in prayer, we notice at least four things. Jesus recognized that prayer was essential to his spiritual life. Throughout the Gospels, we see him in prayer often. Look at a couple of passages. Look at Luke 11, verse 1. One day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples." And I like this one. Look at Luke 6, verse 12. At that time, Jesus went up a hill to pray and spent the whole night there praying to God. I just listened to a passage from Ellen White where she says he frequently did that. Now, did he do that just repeating cliches?
No, he was having heart to heart.
He was having heart to heart, honest, very serious conversations with his father.
Well, the one that nobody had ever seen.
Yeah, planning sessions. That particular passage is just before he chose his cabinet or his disciples.
Right. Exactly.
Selected the ones, 11 of them to be close, and one that intertwined himself in there.
In another place, Ellen White says, when he went to the Garden of Gethsemane on that fateful night, it was because he had frequently gone there to pray. And that's, of course, why Judas knew that's where he would find him. So Jesus, number two, Jesus had specific places that he prayed and specific times to pray. Look at Mark 1, verse 35. Very early the next morning, long before daylight, Jesus got up and left the house. He went out of the town to a lonely place where he prayed. It's hard to pray when there's all kinds of noise going on and people doing crazy things. But if we find a quiet place.
How about a rock band going on?
Yeah, right.
Ken, you had mentioned before about going out and witnessing. And the verse you just read, the next verse after it said, Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else then." Mm-hmm. Further, another place, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come. Mm-hmm. So we should witness, because that's why Jesus came.
Well, Jesus, number three, Jesus regularly prayed aloud. Look at Hebrews 5, 7 and 8. In his life on earth, Jesus made his prayers and requests with loud cries and tears to God, who could save him from death. Because he was humble and devoted, God heard him. But even though he was God's son, he learned through his sufferings to be obedient. Well, so was Jesus praying out loud out there in the wilderness? Apparently so, at least some of the time. And number four, Jesus completely was surrendered to the Father's will in all his prayers. As Gordon suggested, I'm sure that those nighttime prayers were planning sessions for what was going to happen the next day. Could we have that kind of a relationship with God?
If we practiced and made that our goal.
When our prayers and our Bible study and our claiming God's promises are answered in meaningful ways that we can observe, how does that affect our faith? If you really pray for something and then you see it happen, I remember the time when I was working in Nairobi, Kenya, briefly in the doctor's office there, and there was a dentist who was I was on the middle floor and he was on the bottom floor. And we would come up at the end of every day. We lived on the third floor, so there's three floors there. The two of us lived in apartments up on the third floor, out on the balcony, and we would say to each other, "What has the Lord said to you today?" And it seemed like every day there was something that happened that was, you know, sometimes almost miraculous, some great thing that happened, something that would, you know, inspire greater faith. The word confidence, used in the New King James Version in 1 John 5:14, is the word parousia in the original Greek. The meaning of this word was freedom of speech, the freedom in any truly democratic society to speak openly and boldly. God offers us that perfect freedom. We should hold nothing back. In other words, when it comes time to speak to God, You know, you don't have to use very careful King James English. I mean, he might like to hear some King James English once in a while. Nothing wrong with it, but it's not required. Okay?
Probably better off if they don't use King James English. They might understand what's being said.
Well, consider these words. This is absolutely incredible. From Ellen White, once again, this is Steps to Christ, page 100, paragraph 1. That would be easy enough to remember. Keep your wants, your joys, your sorrows, your cares, and your fears before God. You cannot burden him. You cannot weary him. The Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy, James 5:11. His heart of love is touched by our sorrows and even by our utterances of them. Take to him everything that perplexes your mind or the mind. Nothing is too great for him to bear, for he holds up worlds. He rules over all the affairs of the universe. Nothing that in any way concerns our peace is too small for him to notice. There is no chapter in our existence too dark for him to read. I mean, doesn't he know all about it already? Mm-hmm. You know, we might think, oh dear God, I wouldn't want to say that to God. I wouldn't want him to know about it. Well, he knows already. No calamity can befall the least of his children. No anxiety harass the soul. No joy, cheer, no sincere prayer escape the lips of which our Heavenly Father is unobservant or in which he takes no immediate interest. Absolutely everything that happens to us, he cares about it. Have you tried recently to go boldly and confidently before the throne of grace? William Barclay in his commentary says, in the last analysis, the only true prayer is a prayer which says, thy will be done, and whose only request is for grace to accept that will and strength to do it. Wow. So why is it that so many of us fail that? We are so bound up with ourselves that it's sometimes really hard for us to get out of our shells. But God says, come out. I want to meet you. I want to talk to you. Speak what concerns you, no matter how crazy it might seem to you. Talk to God about anything that's of concern to you, and God will say, now we're really talking. That's wonderful. Let me say to you what I want to say to you. Our kind and wonderful Father, with promises like these, how can we go wrong? With promises like these, how can we cling to our selfishness when all these promises which you have made in the Scriptures are there for the asking? Help us to learn what it really means to ask, to believe, and to claim. That's our prayer this day. In the name of Jesus, amen.